should be on the calendar in the kitchen because he went to the calendar.
91 feels like 98 out there.
Tickets from senior.
Patchwork is.
Hoping that they don't.
So my first videos.
Okay, you have yours. Would you like to speak and see if we can hear you?
Oh, I can turn it off.
Test?
I think we can hear. I think it's good. Darlene says she's watching, but I see her right here.
Okay, I'm on the worship channel, but maybe a little louder. Well, I want to hear this. Okay, so I'm on the worship channel. And there we go. Welcome to worship at Patchwork. And we're gathered here on this Father's Day. And welcome to those who are gathered in the room and also those who are joining us via the camera. And there we go.
I can enjoy yourself while you're.
What?
I can enjoy yourself while you're.
I just did it. All right. Okay, so it's Father's Day and we'll hear our lesson today about how the disciples were in a storm and how hard it is to trust when we're in the middle of the storm. And so some thoughts about how we go ahead and do that. So I've got a Darlene is watching with you. So this is the first time I've done it with my. So we'll see. Okay, Jean and I are here. And okay, so things are happening here. When we gather, we share our names. I'm Karen.
I'm Jane.
Bill.
Gail.
Jane.
Nils. Philip.
Helen.
Darlene. Okay, welcome to you and all of you who are joining us either tonight or at some point when you come and join the video again. So I had a lovely list of celebrations which I didn't bring with me, but one celebration was Darlene's birthday party along with the solstice, breakfast and planning and sharing, and we had a lovely time.
Yes.
There'll be some fellowship time available today afterwards. Coffee, whether we need it. And let's see, Susan and Tom have an anniversary.
Susan and Tom have an anniversary.
Right.
We have good news on Tom. He's getting out of the hospital today.
Okay, Tom, what?
He'll probably have to do oxygen, but for a while.
Yeah.
Maybe when he's out and about, he might have to carry some with him. Just kind of depends on how he does. So I think he's going to get sent home with a little oxygen with the idea that maybe this is a good idea for the next week or so. And then it's just kind of like as he feels, I think.
Okay, so Tom North is home from the hospital and.
Well, I don't know that he's actually home yet.
But he's.
The clock is that he is getting out today. But it's just incredibly slow process today because there aren't enough technicians to do all the jobs that need to be done. I think they're trying to cover both hospitals.
Oh.
So anyway, but they're getting out of there today.
There's a reason they call it being a patient.
Yes. You have to be very patient.
Yes, and Helen, you have a birthday coming up.
Thursday.
Thursday. Are there other it's okay. Right. So, I would like to sing My Life Flows On, which is kind of a good being out on the water song. And that is number 781 in the blue book.
Who then is this, that even the wind and the sea
So on this day when we honor fathers, this lesson always reminds me of a remarkable story about my dad. Now, he loved to go fishing. And although we were living right in the heart of Minnesota, Lake Country, for him, real fishing was up north in Canada. Right, you know. And so he was there, fishing in a boat, along with another boat, and two guys in each one. And they saw a fierce storm building. And so then the boats headed back toward the dock. But before they made it, the storm hit with full fury. And suddenly my dad's boat swamped. And the other boat was nowhere to be seen. So my dad emptied the gas can, tied himself to it as a float, and tied his unconscious boatmate to the top of the overturned boat and waited in the storm. That's the sort of thing the disciples were worried about in today's lesson. They were frantic, they were desperate. They're about to go under in the storm. Some of these folks were, you know, they made their living fishing on that lake. But they were frantic. And Jesus doesn't even bother to wake up. Now, he'd been working hard. I'm sure he was pretty tired. But Jesus, can't you see we're in trouble here? Hey. They are questioning whether Jesus cares enough to help. I don't know, did they expect that he would grab another bucket and bail? Because they certainly didn't expect him to just, you know, exorcise the storm so that it was quiet. Because that amazed them, stunned them. They were like, whoa. So that's not what they expected, but they figured Jesus should at least wake up and care and help and stuff. So he does a whole lot more than grab a bucket, of course. He scolds the fierce wind. He tells the sea to calm down, to shut up, basically. And amazingly, it does. I'm thinking the other boats that were with them like that too. That's a little detail in that story. I never could quite figure out where that detail fit in everything. But maybe it's just that what Jesus did helped others too. So the disciples called out to Jesus, even if it was more in fear than in faith. Storm shut up, the sea was calm. They were rescued along with the other boats. Rescued. So here's the rest of the story. My dad. The storm was still whipping up the waves in the lake as they waited. The other boat made it to the dock, but when they looked around and saw that the other boat hadn't made it, they were alone, they turned right out and went straight out again into the storm, into the dark. My dad heard and felt the thunk on his overturned boat before he could get to see the rescuers and before they saw him. Thunk. They literally ran into the boat. Everybody got safely to shore, and after some medical treatment, apparently pouring gas out next to you in the water does not do good things to you. But everyone made it back after some medical treatment safely. They were rescued. And when the storm comes, the overwhelming crisis crashes in, we realize we cannot control chaos. The best we can do is tie ourselves to the gas can. When that chaos comes, when the old animal This story reminds us Jesus is still in the boat. Faced with that fearful storm, the disciples had to ask Jesus in order to get help. And when we remember to ask for the help we need, it helps us to recognize it when we get it. Sometimes we have to wait to ask, or we find ourselves waiting to ask for help until it seems that all is lost. When I first headed down to St. Louis for seminary in 1974, Concordia Seminary in Exile was entering its first full academic year after it had exiled itself from the Missouri City Lutheran Seminary campus there, Concordia, in St. Louis. And a large percentage, almost all of the students and almost all of the faculty walked out. The professors, you know, were being forcibly retired, they were being sidelined, and many of them were formally accused of heresy by the conservatives, who were trying to purge the theological moderates out of the Missouri Synod schools. To get rid of the senior college, they closed it. I mean, there was some wild stuff going on. But in exile, and the classes were held in borrowed spaces, and everyone, professors and students alike, had to scramble and scrape together housing arrangements of various weird kinds. There were no dorms, of course, there, and the faculty had been evicted from their campus housing. So I had lined up a place to land when I got to St. Louis. A former housemate of mine had already gone down there, and she had a place. And turned out I couldn't stay longer than a couple of weeks. I thought, well, you know, everybody's looking for housing. I'll find maybe one of the other women students, and we would share a place. And the other woman student left after 3 days. So one thing after another fell through. I actually sat down on the curb and cried, and I don't cry, you know. So things were looking pretty bleak. And I was like, should I even have come here? The question. Well, then finally, I put out a plea for help. And one of the few other women students who was already at the seminary told me that a family in her church had been looking for a student to live with them in their house, not an apartment, but with their family, and no one had taken them up on it. And so I took the name, I took the phone number, I went back to the place I was staying, called, and left a phone message. So later that afternoon, I got a phone call. Hi, this is Valerie Mobeck. A friend of mine at church said you were looking for a place to stay. Well, now, Valerie had been a couple years ahead of me in my hometown, high school. They were active members of the church I grew up in. Our parents were good friends. Her older sister used to babysit us.
Wow.
Yeah. So, of course, my ears definitely perked up, but I told her I needed to talk with a family that had really been hoping for a student to live with them. And there was a long pause. And Valerie asked, what was that number that you called? And I told her, oh, they gave you my husband's name. That's us. We're the family. I said, I will be over there in 10 minutes. I realized at that point, I realized that Jesus had been in my boat all along, and that it was probably going to be okay for me to be there at seminary after all. That is, you know, an amazing thing. I needed amazing at that point to keep going. But what is it that keeps us from asking for help when we need it. I think pride is part of it, you know? We don't want to admit we need help. I don't know. Or maybe it's that shadow side of pride, which is shame. Maybe we think, I should be able to cope with this on my own. What's wrong with me? Don't want anyone to know. It's hard to be vulnerable and open with fears and failures. Or maybe we just wonder, where in the world has God gotten to? When things around us are such an unrelenting brokenheartedness. Does God even care? Does it matter even? Well, one thing we can say to that is that Jesus knows about all those storms. He faced his own killer storm, prayed on Good Friday, take this cup from me. But the storm of the cross, the tidal wave of death, they were not stilled for Jesus on that fearful day. But even in his storm, he trusted God was in his boat, into your hands. I commend my spirit. When we realize we're not in control, not in control of the storm, the winds and the waves roaring all around us, when we find ourselves increasingly uncharted and in uncertain territory, which I think that feeling has just multiplied itself in the past year and a half or 5 years, maybe. As we're challenged to grow into new ventures and venues, doing things in new ways. I'll check that. Waiting with waves breaking over us. Will God find us in this storm? Holding on and hoping? Being vulnerable does require courage enough to trust. And to help each other do that trusting and live while we're hanging on and hoping. Together we can, I believe, ride out those waves. And it helps to trust that Jesus is in the boat with us. The voice of the God that we meet in Jesus speaks peace, stronger than storms. When the winds of the world beat on us, listen for a grace-filled word of peace. Share it. Help each other to live it.
Yeah. Amen.
Good sound now, so talking louder. Randy Peace is here with us. And all right. Before we get to prayers, and I do invite those who are watching to put prayer requests in the chat box, and we will have those while we join in prayers, but I want to sing. You know, when I get to pick them out, I get to pick out as many as I want. I'm going to sing 735, When God and Human Bonds Are Broken. Kind of talks about what those storms are like.
Thank you.
prayers for Tom and other prayer requests.
I think John Rich, he's at camp.
Yeah.
As nurse John.
Oh.
And he loves it. He loves doing it. But I'm sure that it's hot, it's icky, and we just pray that everything would go smoothly.
Okay. Pray that everything goes smooth with Nurse John at camp this week.
I want to ask for prayers for my friend Sana, who is never good at being alone because it always leaves her feeling abandoned. And this has been a long, hard go. Right. And now her classes are over and she needs to be able to look to something until they pick up again. And so she's in this hopeless area. So prayers for my friend Sana.
She's in the storm.
She's in the storm.
Yeah, so prayers for Sana, for peace and filling her time with things that fill
joyful,
her.
Something joyful. Something joyful.
See, joyful.
Something joyful.
Something joyful. Okay. Sounds like a good plan all around. other prayers.
We give thanks for Darlene, who celebrated her birthday and how much she contributes here to Patchwork.
Okay. So, certainly. Prayers of great thanks for Darlene's person and presence.
Yes.
All that she shares.
Everything.
Of herself.
Sticky buns.
And for Helen, who pretty much single-handedly put hospitality on the map and is having a birthday this Thursday.
So, I didn't know. Almost single-handedly put the hospitality on the map.
I don't think
yes.
I did.
Yes. Inadvertently, but yes.
Well, that's all right. Inadvertently.
Okay, inadvertently.
It's okay.
Yeah. I love doing it.
There you go.
And as Pardon for Love brought a whole string of us along with her.
That's right.
There you go. Well, that is contagious. In the right soil. It grows. Let us pray. We pray for your people everywhere, that they may give good witness to your love, that they might share your vision for our beloved community. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the leaders of this world, of the nations, that they would rule, make judgments, guide with wisdom and compassion, so that your will may be accomplished, that people would be cared for with justice and dignity, and that needs might be met. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who are in any need. Especially we pray for those still hospitalized with COVID, those dealing with treatment and vaccination programs. Especially we pray for those who do not have the resources or insurance to pay for that. And we pray that they would be given help in the process of dealing with their recovery. We pray for Tom, that he would continue to get stronger and more able to get out there and move around, breathe, and deal with stuff. We pray for those we carry in our hearts, that your healing word of peace and wholeness would be heard and felt. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who do ministry in this place, that the programs and the persons involved in sharing and growing and discovering might be blessed. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
that you brought to this place. Especially this week, we give thanks for Helen and for Darlene. And we ask you to bless the new year that they enter into in their life. Gracious God.
Hear our prayer.
Help us to help each other, to be joyful in your presence, to sustain each other, to trust, and to ask when we need. We pray also for John as he shares his gifts, and as people ask him for the help that they need. Bless his time. Gracious God.
Hear our prayer.
Are there other prayers? Chris, thanks for the prayers. I'm walking again, but my breathing is still a little weak.
Chris, better.
Yeah. Okay, that's a good thankful thing. And when we think about things that we're thankful for, we come to a time when we celebrate joys and gifts. So what are some of the joys? I mean, we've already mentioned some birthday girls and sticky buns.
Well, it's a gift to get big, just get together and spend time. Saturday.
Yes.
The gift of being able to do that. Yes. Lovely solstice breakfast.
Yes.
Yep.
Yep. Do some talking and planning.
Just the joy of being together.
Yeah.
And getting to celebrate birthdays and all that too. It's pretty nice.
Yeah. And is today actually the solstice? Is today the longest?
Tomorrow.
21st, tomorrow.
Some, whatever that magic time is.
So, tomorrow.
Sometime tomorrow.
Okay. Other joys. I think the programming that happens here is a joy. The summer programming with the kids, as well as the ongoing hospitality, food pantry, getting ready for back to school, all that stuff. Great joys. And along with joys, there are gifts, some of which will go in this bowl, which is in itself a great gift. And some of them are too big for the bowl.
Well, you know, I just realized Mills is such a gift, always better. That is obvious that he is feeling better. He is moving better. You know, and that's just such a happy thing.
Thank you.
Yes. Yes.
Right. Was to move cane free was a big step.
Yes.
Yeah. Canes are good when you need them, but it's great when you don't. Yeah. These gifts and all of the great joys and gifts that we have been given, we give thanks. And now, as we prepare to share communion, I invite those who are watching with us to, if you would like to join in, to find some bread or crackers, or also some wine or grape juice or some other thing to drink that you would like to use to join us. And after we share in singing, we come to the Hungry Feast, and that is number 766. We'll continue.
Thank you.
gather regularly, and we do come to this hungry feast to remember how Jesus has promised to be with us. And this is a tangible way that we are given to share that promise when we remember how Jesus gathered with his disciples on the night in which he was betrayed, gathered with them at table, and he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body which will be broken for you. Do this as often as you do it to remember me." And he also took the cup and he said, "This cup is my life, my blood poured out for you, for forgiveness." And in the midst of that storm, forgiveness was a promise needed, if not heard right away. But yet it's a promise that we still get to as we remember and celebrate and give thanks for God's promise to be with us as we taste the Lord's goodness. And so we will share. I will give you a piece of bread, and on the larger tray are wine glasses, and the smaller tray are some grape juice glasses. And and share. We are almost through with our service. We have some announcements to share.
Yes. After July, I guess it's the 10th. July 10th is the first. We're going to try.
The 11th. Second Sunday.
The second Sunday, we're going to go back to, we're going to test our potluck. Following worship that day. That would be our first time.
Okay. Yeah, we talked about that at the solstice breakfast. So.
Do you want to say anything about?
I have a question. What did you decide for silver, for plates and?
Oh, we're going to do the paper plate thing.
Okay.
And rather than, if we could rotate it around, as far as different people bringing it. We're going to do paper plates, we're going to do paper cups, we're going to do
plastic forks.
We're not going to do any washing.
Right, so you want to bring your own dishes and take them home and wash them?
Yes.
Right. That's an option. So one option would be to bring your own dishes and take them home, wash them. Or if you don't want to cook, you might want to check and see if we need paper plates.
That's the option.
So that's another option. So you have some back to school stuff coming up, or is that pretty well
back to school stuff is coming up. It's pretty well organized. We'll be calling for volunteers shortly.
Okay.
And it's a huge sale because we had an entire sale organized a year ago, pre-COVID, when we had to skip. And then there have been donations coming in and all sorts of things. So the back to school closet is now a back to school jam-packed closet.
Okay.
So it's going to take some volunteers, and we'll let you know.
Okay, volunteer requests coming up. Mm-hmm. Speaking of asking for help.
And it will also take a few more because we are going to practice social distancing. People cannot just come in and jam the room. It just won't work. We're not comfortable with that. It doesn't feel safe to us. So it's a little bigger this year and a little rethought.
In ballpark, what are we looking at for dates?
30th.
Okay. 30th of July.
Mm-hmm. For this, that's the date of the
for back to school.
Yeah, and the Monday before is going to be the get everything out of the closet day. Okay. The Tuesday will be bagging day.
Okay, so Monday and Tuesday before the 30th, volunteers will be needed to help get things out and set up and packed away or packed in the right places. And
I will tell you truly, I am saying all these things not as the chairman of that project. The chair this year is Robin Musgrave, and Jill Heminger is the second. And I just kind of hang out.
Okay.
I'm going to try to get Kiwanis workers to bring this stuff out of the storage area.
Yes.
So I will make that that will be my goal for Wednesday when we meet.
Okay.
That I get some volunteers.
So the volunteer process is in process.
Yes, board meeting, et cetera, et cetera. Everybody gets to play.
Okay. So I understand that there are some sorry, folks who are watching us remotely, but there are some sticky buns with coffee that you can.
And there's also a cake out there too.
Another birthday cake.
Some more birthday cake. So we'll include you in this birthday cake too. How about that?
Why not?
Yeah, I will share my birthday cake with her. So she will be here next time.
That's right.
Okay. Well, good. Any other announcements to share? Okay, we're going to go out singing, Go My Children with My Blessing, and that is number 721.